The term Afrofuturism first appeared in an essay titled Black to the Future by Mark Deary in 1994. But its roots go back to a fateful night in the late 1930s in Huntsville, Alabama. On that peculiar evening, a beam of light shot down from the sky and lifted Herman Sonny Blunt into an alien spacecraft. On a voyage to Jupiter, his alien captors prompted him with a mission: to transport black people away from the violence and racism of planet Earth. Sonny became Sun Ra, who worked on the other side of time. His songs were both far out and yet somehow familiar, a reaction to the trauma of black life in the United States. He believed no place on Earth was safe for black people, and who could argue otherwise? His spacecraft was his ark. His band was known as his orchestra. On his cosmic voyage came many earthly stops. A stint in jail during World War II for being a conscientious objector. The cover of Rolling Stone in 1969. Later that year, a concert in Egypt and a visit to the pyramids, where Africans first looked to the stars. And in 1978, the orchestra performed on Saturday Night Live. Nowhere was the message clearer than in his 1973 film, Space is the Place, a movie that found Sun Ra recruiting Oakland's black citizens to join his space program. There are less than a dozen black characters in the entire Star Trek franchise. One in the original Star Wars trilogy and none at all in the Jetsons. It was imperative for Sun Ra and his orchestra to fly their own spaceship. Ever since the orchestra knocked at the door of the cosmos, black musicians have imagined themselves surfing the astral plane, traveling through space and time. The influence of this Afrofuturism has even found its way to Hot Topic, where you can now purchase a shirt that reads, "Space is the place." Sun Ra left Earth for the final time in 1993. What does it say about how far we have or have not come if this message still resonates with each new generation? The year was 1966 and Lyndon B. Johnson was president. Race riots continued across the United States, Muhammad Ali refused to serve in the Vietnam War, and the Beatles were bigger than Jesus. During Jim Crow, NASA relied on the mathematical equations of three black women to win the space race. In 1966, however, a TV show called Star Trek appointed a black woman as one of the commanders of its own spacecraft, the Starship Enterprise. Lieutenant Nyota Uhura, played by Nichelle Nichols, was the first black character in a leading role to be depicted in outer space. Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. recognized the significance of the ship's diverse crew. According to Nichols, it was King who convinced her to stay on after the first season, telling her, "You are our image of where we're going. You are 300 years from now." He went on, "For the first time, we are seen as what we should be. You don't have a black role, you have an equal role." 30 years from Uhura's debut, a black woman would reach the true final frontier. Astronaut Mae Jemison entered Earth's orbit aboard the Space Shuttle Endeavour on September 12, 1992. Black people remain criminally underrepresented in Hollywood's biggest sci-fi films. What kind of message is sent when future worlds are depicted without them? Afrofuturism and characters like Uhura are important because they shed light on black people's ability to create, carry, and elevate sci-fi roles, even as Hollywood fails to catch on. In the 60s, Lieutenant Uhura helped command the Starship Enterprise. In the 70s, George Clinton's mothership helped to expand the mythology of what we came to know as Afrofuturism. Sun Ra's out to lunch, the same place I eat at, George Clinton once said in an interview. Me and Sun Ra and Jimi Hendrix were eating at the same lunch counter, he then later remarked. Clinton's songs and album covers only strengthened the idea. Albums like Atomic Dog, Mothership Connection, Unfunky UFO, Dr. Funkenstein and the Cosmic Slop gave the world a taste of black people travelling through space and time for advancement, enlightenment and fun. Free your mind and your ass will follow, George proclaimed. Open up your funkin' mind and you can fly. His songs have since been sampled over 400 times. And in 2011, the Library of Congress declared that his album, Mothership Connection, had an enormous influence on jazz, rock, and dance music. There is no doubt that George Clinton, Parliament, Funkadelic, and their disciples will continue to inspire Afronauts to free their minds and asses for all time. Though Sun Ra was well into his career before Jimi Hendrix released his first album, Hendrix was the first popular black artist to make science fiction and space travel a reoccurring theme in his music. While Sun Ra's plans was to bring black people out of space, Hendrix wanted to use his music to help humans dismantle racist systems and find love. Both men experimented with new technology to give their music futuristic sounds. Both wrote songs about Neptune and Saturn and claimed to have interacted with aliens. But one thing Sun Ra never got to do was battle the gods. Hendrix did just that one evening in 1966. It was Hendrix's first time in London, and the supergroup called Cream had a show that night. At the time, their guitarist, Eric Clapton, was God. Hendrix's manager, a mutual friend, introduced the two, and Hendrix wasted no time asking Clapton if they could jam together. He agreed. In a matter of moments, Hendrix had dethroned the king in the king's land in front of the king's people. Though Hendrix and Clapton would become close friends, the context of the moment still matters. At the height of the civil rights movement, when white artists and label owners got rich covering songs by black artists, the importance of Hendrix's victory that night could not be overstated. To date, Hendrix continues to inspire young Afronauts like Andre 3000, Janelle Monae, Future and Wiz Khalifa to wave their freak flags high. We can't talk about Afrofuturism without mentioning Missy Elliott, one of the most popular hip-hop artists of all time. With over 30 million albums sold, Missy used her popularity to project images of black people in their own science fiction universes. Aided by visionary director Hype William and Timbaland's spaced out beats, Missy descended from planet rock to show the world what awaited in a future built by black people. This trip blew the Jetsons out of the water. In 1999, 7 years after NASA, astronaut Mae Jemison became the first black woman in space. Missy Elliott then released her debut album, Super Duper Fly. The album's second single was Sock It To Me, which found Missy, Lil Kim, The Brat, and Timbaland planet hopping to flee their alien assailants. But it's not the only Missy Elliott music video with a sci-fi theme. The vast majority of Missy's videos explore space travel, contact with alien spacecraft, superpowers, and explicit use of fantasy elements. On Missy's songs, Timbaland would often make a cameo, playing Jarvis to Missy's Iron Man, Alfred to Missy's Batman, patching in to lay the blueprint for a mission. These moments, coupled with Missy's witty lyrics, evoked otherworldly imagery well before you even saw the video. Sun Ra had faded by the height of the music video era, so Missy was presenting an image of black people that the world had only truly heard before. In doing so, she opened a lane for artists like Future, Kanye West, and Janelle Monae to imagine themselves in space.